Solitary and December surprises in the shadow of the Statue of Liberty. Mikhail Gorbachev meets with President Reagan and President-elect Bush on Governor's Island in New York Harbor. Gorbachev mounting a new troops and weapons reduction offensive. This is the CBS Evening News. Dan Rather reporting. Good evening. On a stunning sun-splashed day in New York, Mikhail Gorbachev makes a splash of his own, talking up Soviet troop reductions. In private, at a three-way summit, before a world audience at the United Nations. Gorbachev wasted no time in delivering his headline grabber of the day.
The Soviet Union has taken a decision to reduce its armed forces. Within the next 2 years, their numerical strength will be reduced by 500,000 men. The numbers of conventional armaments will also be substantially reduced.
Gorbachev's arms and charms offensive was light years away from the belligerence and bluster of Nikita Khrushchev at the UN almost three decades earlier. Still, in his own polished way, Gorbachev tried to dominate and set the agenda for what came next. The three-way summit, Gorbachev, Reagan, Bush. Together on a tiny island, Gorbachev denied that his troop cut proposals were being met by Kremlin hardliner resistance at home. He came close to saying, read my lips.
Yep.
No?
Yep.
No?
Yep.
Thank you.
Yep. No.
The summit and superpower lunch lasted 2 hours. And how did it go?
Read our smile. Read our smile.
Now to help flesh out our coverage of this extraordinary day of summitry and surprises, our man in Moscow, Barry Peterson, is here in New York this week to begin our coverage of the Gorbachev gambit.
It was a crystal clear dawn, a gift to Mikhail Gorbachev here to paint a picture of a new Soviet Union. His motorcade sped through rush hour Manhattan, arriving at the United Nations, where Raisa flashed the first smile and Gorbachev got his first ever look at this world body. Gorbachev picked the UN as his stage. He practically invited himself here. And when the curtain went up, he was more than ready to deliver.
The Soviet leadership has decided to demonstrate once again its readiness to reinforce this healthy process not only by words, but also by deeds.
The first deed, unilateral troop reduction, slashing 500,000 troops from its total force of 5 million over the next 2 years. The second deed, pulling 50,000 Soviet troops, as well as tanks and other equipment, out of Eastern Europe.
Today,
the challenge was clear. The Soviets have made a move. Will the Americans follow suit? But it may spell trouble back home. The popular Soviet chief of staff, Sergei Akhramayev, retired today, reportedly for health reasons. But it may be an ominous sign that many in the military don't support Gorbachev's decision. And there was more. On cutting nuclear arms, let's get on with it, he said, and offered a thinly veiled invitation to a superpower summit.
Prerequisites exist to make 1989 a decisive year.
On Afghanistan, the offer of a ceasefire on January 1st and a request for UN peacekeeping troops. One had to remember that it came from a country with a history of scorn for the UN. He said Yasser Arafat should have been allowed to address the UN in New York, saying it while Secretary of State George Shultz, the man who denied Arafat a visa, sat in the audience. On human rights, he cited changes in Soviet law and letting Jews immigrate as another example of the new Soviet Union.
This removes from the agenda the problem of so-called refuseniks.
The man on center stage got the applause he wanted, then was off to Governor's Island to get the reaction from his most important audience, lunch with President Reagan and President-elect Bush.
This is Bill Plant on Governor's Island. From the United Nations, the leader of the Soviet Union made his way to the mini-summit meeting the old-fashioned way, as aircraft flew high above, writing a welcome message in smoke on the wind. President Reagan was there, ready with the kind of greeting reserved for those who have long since taken one another's measure. And Vice President Bush, appearing eager to step into his new role. Everyone was all smiles and optimism and ready for the camera.
We've accomplished much. There are other things still to do.
Inside, the first questions were all to Mr. Gorbachev, who had seized the day's agenda with his UN announcement of military cuts.
First of all, I have explained that we are taking these steps unilaterally.
Over lunch, a discussion of human rights, Afghanistan, and the Soviet Union's own internal problems, as well as the Gorbachev plan for troop cuts, which Mr. Reagan welcomed.
That wasn't a proposal, that was a decision that has been made.
And what do you think of that decision, sir?
Naturally, I heartily approve.
George Bush, just 6 weeks from the Oval Office, today was still the loyal vice president.
Or what the president says.
The Secretary of State, while pointing out that Mr. Gorbachev's military cuts would still leave the Soviets with superior strength, seemed nonetheless optimistic about the relationship.
Oh, I don't know whether you want to say that's the end of the Cold War or not, but it's different, a lot different, and from my taste, a lot better.
Because this is a time of transition in the U.S. government, with neither Mr. Reagan nor Mr. Bush in any position to make any kind of deal, the U.S. wanted this really to be a kind of extended photo opportunity. Mr. Gorbachev obviously had different ideas, but in the end, the passing of the torch to George Bush was exactly what the White House got. The three men stopped before they left to gaze across the harbor at the Statue of Liberty, shuffling about with an interpreter on the makeshift platform for the cameras. Then, at the dock, a last goodbye for these two men who had come so far on what seemed so improbable a journey.